Hello and welcome back to the channel. So in this lecture we are going to discuss about Hadoop ecosystem. So the last lecture was all about some introductory part of Hadoop, where we have discussed what is Hadoop, why it is needed and the core components of Hadoop in detail. So in today's lecture we are going to see different components present in the Hadoop ecosystem which works together to tackle the big data problem. So without further ado, let's get into it. So as you can see in this figure, these are all the components which works together for storing, processing and analysis of big data. And we are going to discuss them one by one. So here you can also notice some Hadoop core components such as HDFS, Yarn and MapReduce that we have already discussed in detail in the previous lecture. So if you haven't seen it, just watch it to get more details. So let's start with the most important component of Hadoop, which is HDFS. It is nothing but Hadoop Distributed File System. HDFS is a primary storage system of Hadoop, which stores the data in distributed manner on the commodity hardware, which can be easily replaceable. So previous lecture, we have already discussed how the HDFS works and how it stores the data by dividing it into equal blocks and store it in the distributed manner. So basically it has two components which are given here. The first one is a name node and second one is a data node. So name node is also known as a master node, which does not actually store the data. Instead it stores the metadata. So what do you mean by metadata? So metadata is nothing but it will contain the information of number of blocks, their locations, rack information and other details related to data node. And the next component is data node. This is also known as a slave node and it is responsible to actually store your data files. So the data node also performs read and write operation as per the request provided by clients and also replicates to achieve the fault tolerant system. The next component of Hadoop ecosystem is MapReduce. So MapReduce is a processing layer of Hadoop and also the core Hadoop ecosystem component. MapReduce programs are parallel in nature and are very useful for performing large-scale data analysis. So basically it has two phases, map phase and reduce phase. So map phase will takes the set of data and convert it into another set of data where the individual elements will be broken down into tuples of key value pairs. And the reduce function takes the output of map, applies some aggregation and writes the output to the HDFS. So this is how MapReduce function works. So this is how the HDFS and MapReduce are positioned in the Hadoop ecosystem chart. So as you can see, the HDFS stores all the data and MapReduce will be your processing layer which processes the data stored in the HDFS. But it needs help of the another component in the Hadoop ecosystem, which is Hadoop Yarn, which is a resource negotiator in the Hadoop ecosystem. So let's talk about it. So our next core component of Hadoop is Yarn. So Yarn is nothing but yet another resource negotiator. It's a Hadoop ecosystem component which will provide the resource management task. And it is also one of the most important component of Hadoop ecosystem. So it is responsible managing and monitoring workloads. It also allows multiple data processing engines such as real-time streaming as well as batch processing to handle data stored on a single platform. Our next component is Hive. Hive is nothing but a data warehouse system for running SQL-like queries on top of our Hadoop files which are present in HDFS. So it is used for querying and analyzing large data set which are stored in HDFS. So it basically does three main functions: querying, summarizing and analysis. And the language used is a HiveQL, which is very similar to SQL. So if you are familiar with SQL, you can easily write queries and do analysis on the data stored into HDFS and you don't need to write a MapReduce functions which will be very complicated. As you can see in this chart, Hive sits on top of MapReduce. So whenever you submit a Hive query, it will be converted as a MapReduce operation and then goes to the Yarn which will do the resource management, and we can perform different operation on the data stored on the HDFS. So these are the basic components of Hive. The metastore, which is used for storing the metadata of files. The next one is driver for managing the life cycle of HiveQL statement. The query compiler, which will compile the HiveQL queries into a direct acyclic graph. So what is this directed acyclic graph? That we will see in the further lectures. And the last one is Hive server, which provides a thrift interface, and the JDBC ODBC server. Our next component is Apache Pig, which is also similar to Hive and used for analyzing and query data files which are stored in HDFS. But it has its own language known as Pig Latin, which is also very similar to SQL. So it will load the data, applies required filters, and dumps the data in the required format. So for program execution, it will be requiring a Java runtime environment. As you can see in this chart, Pig also sits on top of MapReduce, which uses YARN as a resource negotiator, and the Pig queries will be converted into a MapReduce function, which will transform the data stored into HDFS, and you can write it as per the format that you require. Our next Hadoop component is HBase. So Apache HBase is a Hadoop ecosystem component, which is a distributed database, and it is designed to store structured data in tables, which will have billions of rows as well as it can have millions of columns. This is very highly scalable, distributed, and a NoSQL database. So you might ask, what is NoSQL? As you already know, SQL does have a specified schema, but on the other hand, NoSQL doesn't have any specified schema. So the difference between them, that's a whole another topic, which we will discuss in the separate lecture. Coming to HBase, it is built on top of HDFS and provides a real-time access to read and write data into HDFS. It is beneficial for instant querying the data stored in the HDFS. As you can see in this chart, it is sit on top of HDFS. It stores the data in HDFS, and you can do different operation and can have a very low latency system where you can query data stored in HDFS. Our next component is Spark. So Spark is a huge framework and can be used as a standalone itself. It is an open source distributed computing engine for processing and analyzing large amount of data in a real time. It runs even 100 times faster than MapReduce. It will provide us in-memory computation of data, which will be used for processing, analyzing, streaming data. So for example, Instagram, Twitter feeds, stock market data, as well as banking data. Basic example of a real-time streaming data. So it works on the master-slave architecture. So master will drive the program, and the worker nodes, which are also known as slave nodes, will do all the operation. As you can see in this chart, Spark sits on top of YARN, which uses YARN as a resource negotiator, and we can process the data stored into HDFS, and it also has their own API. So in the Spark ecosystem, there is Spark SQL, which is widely used nowadays to perform different SQL operation on your Spark RDDs or Spark data frame. Spark streaming is there to deal with the streaming data, and other APIs as well, such as graphics, mllib, which is used for enabling machine learning capabilities to your big data. Spark ecosystem is a whole lot of other subjects that we are going to discuss in the different course which is dedicated to Spark. But as of now, you just have to remember that Spark will use Hadoop as their storage layer as well as the resource management layer. The next component is Apache Sqoop, which is very important. So Sqoop is a tool which is used for importing or exporting data from different RDBMS sources into HDFS. So you can either import the data from RDBMS to HDFS, otherwise you can export the data which is present in HDFS into other sources. It can also import the data into HDFS or Hive, and it works well with Teradata, Netezza, Oracle, MySQL. As you can see, Sqoop will sit here, and arrow will mention the import and export activities that we can do with the capability of Sqoop. There are also different tools such as Kafka, which is used for streaming data, and Flume, which is similar to Sqoop, that we are going to discuss in the next topic. So we can say these three components are not the part of Hadoop ecosystem, but in real world scenario, these three tools can be very useful if you are implementing Hadoop into your project. Our next component is Apache Flume, which is also used for importing large amount of data and write it to the HDFS. So Flume will efficiently collect, aggregate, and will move large amount of data files from its origin, and it will send it back to the HDFS. So it is very fault tolerant and a reliable mechanism, and will allow data flow from source into Hadoop environment. Using this tool, we can get data from multiple servers immediately into Hadoop. We can use it to import data from Facebook, Twitter, as well as different web servers. So the Flume will also sits besides the Sqoop. So I hope you're already aware of that. Now we will go to the next tool, which is Ambari. So Ambari, which is another Hadoop component, is a management platform for provisioning, monitoring, and securing the Apache Hadoop cluster. So it is just a web UI by which you can control all the components which you have deployed into your Hadoop cluster. But this chart doesn't contain Ambari, but it will sit on top of each and every service. So whatever you have deployed to your Hadoop cluster, you can monitor it, or you can access those tools using Ambari web UI. Our next component is a Zookeeper. So Zookeeper is nothing but a centralized service, and it is a part of a Hadoop ecosystem, which will be used for maintaining configuration information, as well as naming, as well as providing group services, and so on. So it manages and coordinates a large cluster of machines. So as you can see in this chart, Zookeeper sits beside all the services, as it is a centralized service and can maintain all the Hadoop ecosystem components which are deployed into your Hadoop cluster. And our last component of today's lecture is Oozie. So Oozie is nothing but a workflow scheduler system for managing Hadoop jobs. So if you want to perform any operation on a regular basis, so either doing manually, you can just set up a Oozie job which will run it according to the schedule that you need. So it can also combine multiple jobs sequentially into one logic, and it fully integrates with Apache Hadoop stack, and you can run Hadoop jobs for MapReduce, Pig, Hive, and Sqoop as well. So in Oozie, you can create a DAG of workflow. So DAG is nothing but directed acyclic graph, which is a topic for a separate conversation, which we will see in the upcoming lectures. By this help of Oozie, your life can be simpler, and you can start, stop, suspend, and as well as rerun the jobs whenever needed. So I hope you understood the different components of Hadoop and their applications. And I have tried to cover all of them, but you can see there are some services which I haven't covered in this, such as mahout, which is used for enabling machine learning capabilities on your big data files, as well as there is a Cassandra, which is similar to HBase. Also, there are services like Kafka, which is used for dealing with streaming data, such as web logs or Twitter feeds, etc. From the next lectures, we are going to take a deep dive and learn all the tools in the Hadoop ecosystem. I hope you like this lecture, so please subscribe to the channel and also ring the notification bell to get the latest updates. And don't forget to follow us on our social media that I have linked in the description below. Thanks for watching.